I'm Tom Rothman of 20th Century Fox. Welcome to Fox Legacy. We're glad to have you with us.
We're looking at the worldwide destruction of every major city in the next 36 hours.
We're being exterminated.
In most businesses, if you hear you have a disaster on your hands, I suppose it's a bad thing. In the movie business, however, a disaster can actually be a good thing if it's a disaster movie. You see, whether it's floods or asteroids or epidemics, global warming, or even aliens, like those gentlemen, which actually produce the alien invasion disaster subspecies of movies, there's something about the human psyche that makes us love to watch the world get destroyed. I guess there's something very primal at play there. Destruction of the world stories go back as far as recorded time. Noah's Ark, anyone? Those stories continued over the centuries, and when media became able to reach a mass audience, say, in the golden age of radio, end of the world actually became big entertainment. Orson Welles' 1938 radio broadcasts of H.G. Wells' classic War of the Worlds, where aliens allegedly invaded New Jersey, fooled millions of people into thinking it was really happening. With movies, disasters got epic visuals to match the story. Now, we here at Fox have made more than our fair share of successful disaster movies. 1937's In Old Chicago recreated the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. What fun. The Poseidon Adventure in 72 turned a cruise ship upside down. 74 is The Towering Inferno. And we've actually had two versions of the sinking of the Titanic. The 1953 version with Clifton Webb and Barbara Stanwyck, and the 97 version, that little film that went on to be the highest grossing movie of all time. In 2004, we released a film called The Day After Tomorrow, where climate change devastates the entire Northern Hemisphere. That movie was directed by Roland Emmerich, as is the movie you're going to watch tonight, Independence Day. Roland is a man with a special gift for the enormous, original visual imagery that elevates the very best films in this genre. And he can also manage the tricky tonal balance required to let an audience enjoy destruction. Independence Day reveals Roland's special gift for these awe-inspiring visuals. In ID4, as opposed to using CGI, the buildings that are destroyed were actually miniatures, but this doesn't necessarily mean they were tiny. The White House replica was actually over 5 feet tall. The shot blowing up the White House provided the visual signature for the first and the best Super Bowl movie commercial ever made. "Enjoy the Super Bowl," it said. "It may be your last." Keep in mind, of course, that all the imagery in Independence Day and other films like it predate 9/11 and the shock of reality that that brought. Personally, I don't believe those images would pass muster today. Because today, for all the explosive bombast in Independence Day, there is something ironically quaint, naive, almost nostalgic in the pre-9/11 disaster film. It was innocent fun in ways that it really can't be today.
Oh, crap.
Characters live, characters die. But we, as an audience, survive through it all. And when the lights come up, we've experienced what the Greek tragedians call catharsis. When you get through something tragic and devastating and you live to tell about it, you release that emotional energy, a cleansing of the spirit.
Look at you! Ship all banged up! Who's the man? Huh? Who's the man?
To heighten that communal end of the world sense, these films usually feature a lot of characters. A part of that is simply the epic nature of the storytelling, but also, if you have a lot of characters, you, as a viewer, have the ability to connect with one or more of them. They're your emotional entry point into the story. You can sympathize with the Kennedy-esque president with a wife and a daughter, the fighter pilot that didn't get into NASA, the divorced scientist who hasn't reached his full potential, or on and on. Each of these characters make a contribution towards solving the overall crisis. They have to work together, band together. And invariably in these movies, There will always be the moment where one of the characters makes the fighting spirit speech.
You will once again be fighting for our freedom. Not from tyranny, oppression, or persecution, but from annihilation.
The overblown and emotional rhetoric of this underdog valiance, from Braveheart to Shakespeare and back again, is always my own favorite trope in war disaster films. Independence Day actually being a combination of both, a war disaster film. Henry V, who has hopelessly outnumbered troops before the Battle of Agincourt, he says, "We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother." Bill Pullman, playing the President of the United States in tonight's movie. "We will not go quietly into the night. We will not vanish without a fight. We are going to survive. Today we celebrate our Independence Day."
Today we celebrate our Independence Day.
Doesn't it inspire you to jump into the cockpit and shoot at some aliens? Or maybe punch one of them in the nose and say, "Welcome to Earth."
Welcome to Earth.
Enjoy the movie, and I'll see you afterwards. People often ask me, is it hard to decide to spend hundreds of millions of dollars on making and marketing one movie? Well, yeah, it is. But in truth, it doesn't usually happen all in one fell swoop. Instead, 9 times out of 10, movies are made up of a series of small decisions made over many years involving smaller incremental costs. You buy a book, you hire a screenwriter, you commission some designs, and then only in the end do you realize the enormity of the risk-making decision that you're involved in. Independence Day, however, was the very opposite of that. It was an all-or-nothing, all-in, in-or-out for the whole kit-and-caboodle type roll of the dice. That's because it's what's called in our business a spec package. Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin had written the full script, had a budget, had a cast in mind, start date, and obviously a determination that their film should be released on July 4th, Independence Day. They didn't want, or more to the point, they didn't need, a development deal to work on the script. What they wanted was a deal to make the movie itself. And unlike the usual situation, because they'd written the script themselves on their own, taking no money from anyone, they owned it. And they could set any terms they wanted, as long as there were buyers. But because the script was great, and because Roland is a great director, there were, in fact, plenty of buyers. Now, this is where certainty and aggression mark the gifted studio executive. That script was sent out to every studio in Hollywood. Peter Chernin, chairman of 20th Century Fox at the time, read it that night. And while the other companies around town were discussing it, or getting collective opinions, or evaluating it, or hedging their bets, he was doing a deal to buy the property, greenlight the movie, all within 24 hours of the moment he got the script. And it's lucky for the rest of us at Fox that he did. Independence Day, or as Bob Harper's genius marketing shorthand dubbed it, ID4, went on to become one of the biggest box office hits in the history of our company, grossing over $800 million worldwide. That's behind only Star Wars and Titanic. So, all in all, I'd say that was a pretty damn good day's work at the office for Peter.
I'm back!
As for me, I think I'll head back to my office in the eternal hope that sitting on my desk right now tonight is some new spec by a young, genius, unknown filmmaker, all packaged and just waiting for the push of a button to make the next mega hit. Or maybe not, but hope springs eternal.
Oh! Elvis has left the building!
For Fox Legacy, I'm Tom Rothman. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.